it felt good to see two black characters, a man and a woman, who didn't come from stereotypical black stories. Both successful, well-read families, both well-educated, who fell in love and were able to be together and both in healthy relationships.
First of all, I absolutely loved the movie. Obviously, I'm very happy that it's going on. One of the things that I wanted to talk about with you guys first is that, every year different networks put on these big holiday campaigns with big programming. And finally, I feel like we now have stories of color with leads of color in these amazing holiday movies. So how has it been for you to watch the transition over the years and then really to be a part of the change with having leads of color in these types of films?
Go ahead.
For me, I have had the beautiful luxury throughout my career of working for people that look like me and representing people that look like me and telling stories for people that look like me. However, they have not always been Christmas. I've done a lot of television shows. I've done started with Tyler Perry on House of Pain and done Everybody Hates Chris and the list goes on, but I have been very proud of the blackness in the spaces that I'm in. However, when it came to this particular project, it was just extraordinary all the way around. Not only is it our stories, but it is our stories in a truthful, non-stereotypical way.
Yes.
I think a lot of times you see the stories about going back to Big Mama's house, and those are true stories for some people, but that is not all of us. And culturally, I think there's a large section that gets forgotten in the Black community. And this movie does a great job of showing successful, educated, well-manicured Black men and women in their respective spaces that don't assimilate, that are not trying to be anything other than who they are, but show the blackness that our parents taught us to be.
Now,
I have to agree with that.
well, for you, Deval, you start as a former football player turned sports broadcaster, and your fans know your history within sports. Was it one of the reasons why you were attracted to the character because of the sports connection?
Absolutely. I feel like my story is unique. Being an NFL athlete and then retiring from the NFL and going into broadcast journalism for about 4 or 5 years, and then transitioning into a TV film, taking this role kind of brought me back home. It's great for people to see me in that light again and say, wait a minute, didn't he play football? Because it reminds them that, yeah, he's done things before. But to piggyback off of what Eva said, it felt good to see two black characters, a man and a woman, who didn't come from stereotypical black stories, both successful, well-read families, both well-educated, who fell in love and were able to be together and both in healthy relationships while falling in. It was just like so much positivity, but it wasn't like super pushed on us where it's not realistic. It was like, this is the norm. Like, there are black people who exist like this. There wasn't a monolithic view of what blackness is supposed to be. It wasn't the typical struggle film. So I felt like playing this character allowed me to show people in a way where I've come from as well. Not just Jordan, but also DeVal as well.
Now, there's also a big inclusion of social media throughout the film. It's really used as a second medium to tell the story. So, I guess this could be for both of you, even though you guys use social media like very differently. I know DeVal, you use it a lot, with you and your family. You've really become a social media influencer, and I feel like you've somewhat built, or it has helped you build this last phase of your career, where Eva, you came up, earlier on the modeling scene. But what have you guys learned about how the platform can either make or break your career? And especially with you too, Eva, at one point you were on reality television.
Well, Miss Brenda, I would like to say I helped start reality television. We didn't have a name for the genre. It started in the early 2000s.
Yes, ANTM, we know season three.
ANTM, there was no reality. All we had was American Idol, which started the same year, and there was a show called Survivor. Besides from that, there was nothing. It
I
was not
guess
called
the real world, I guess too.
in the
Yeah.
real world, right? So there was really no reality television, when I first started out in this business, and it has now done its thing and become a pretty big influence on a lot of our lives. I think for a lot of reasons. For one, for what Deval just asked the last question, a lot of the stories are just not true. When you see stories written about us and you see actors acting in a film, you're like, I would never do that. My mama would never say that. A kid would never do that. So reality TV brought a sense of truth to the home where people that were tired of the same redundant scripted work being done and played by the same people, reality was able to bring them in touch. But social media has had such an influence on our everyday lives, from the way you twist your hair to the way I wear what I wear to the music that we listen to. It's such an influence, from motivation to being able to bully and tear you down. And this movie, I think, did a great job of showing how much social media is interwoven into our relationships, into the way we work, our ability to either keep our job or lose our job, the way people look at us, optics. Yeah. And so it was just a real take on the life that we live today. You meet a guy, the first thing you do, you check his Instagram. I mean, that's the world we live in today.
Yeah, I would have to agree. I feel like social media in this day and age reminds me of when hip hop first started in the 90s, right? Remember when hip hop first started and they were like, oh, hip hop's not going to last. It's not going to last. And then when we got into the mid 90s, Will Smith had his own TV show. Queen Latifah had her own TV show. Heavy D was doing TV. Eve had her own TV show. And then people started to run to hip hop to say, these people have influence. Mm-hmm. These could be our next best creators. When I look at social media now, you have all these influencers who are getting a ton of other opportunities who are now becoming our creators. Look at the Issa Rae's of the world. You know, they started on social media to show people their gift. Now you have a chance to get direct access to the audience. So now the producers have to say, wait a minute, let me pay attention to this little person in the corner who has everyone else's attention. And I'll give you a perfect example. I was pitching 6 years ago a TV show about loosely based on my life, about father who retired from football, who came home and be a stay-at-home dad. I was in the same meetings at Netflix, ABC, NBC. No one wants to see that. There's not enough at stake. I start posting on social media. I built 2 million followers. The same producers are coming back to me saying, hey, can we get these stories for network? Yeah. I've been offered an opportunity to write. You know, I look at Jamie Foxx now, have a show about being a single dad. Kevin Hart has a show about being a single dad. Netflix has a hit TV show called A Family Reunion about a retired football player who is now a dad. So it just shows you how the influence of social media has completely changed the TV and movie landscape.
Yes. Because
producers can look at their phones and say, I think I'm going to just make that into a movie. So social media is huge and it's not going anywhere.
Nope.
Well, since the movie is based upon Christmas, and one of the blessings that I feel like the holiday season brings us is the ability to be able to slow down, spend time with family, take some time off. But the big thing in the movie that Eva's character deals with in the beginning is that she's having a hard time saying no to work. And I feel like as we get more established in our careers, that becomes more and more of a reality. So how are you both going about relishing in the holidays this time and putting work to the side?
You know, it's so funny you said that, because Deval and I, we were just talking about this. Yeah. We were talking about, yeah. I have done, by the grace of God, these are no complaints, champagne problems. I have worked every single month for the last 26 months on a production. Mama Tad. Yeah. So this year I decided, I just wrapped my last production a week and a half ago. And I was just telling D, I said, you know what? I'm taking off until January. Until January, because I got to start production in January. But until January, I am not taking any more jobs. I was just offered a film. I said no. And my agent was like, what do you mean? I said, no, I'm not doing any more work at all unless it's with my family. I'm planning Thanksgiving. I am preparing for Christmas. I want to see my family. I want to see D and his family and all the rest of my friends and their kids, and just try to find that balance. And that balance means saying no sometimes.
Absolutely. I agree with Eva. We literally were talking about this while we were waiting for interviews. We were talking about spending time together, because I wrapped my last production for the year on Friday. And a lot like Eva, when all the production started coming back from 2020, they were looking for talent. I, like Eva, were one of the people that they were calling. We need you for this. We need you for that. We need you for this. And I just said, yes, yes, yes.
Yep.
After Friday, no, No, I have four sons. I have a wife. I need to focus on producing a family environment that's conducive for all of us to be successful. And that's all I want.
And Eva, before I let you go, we chatted a little bit about hair. And one of the things I loved is that you decided to style your natural locks for the film. So I'm not sure if that was intentional or not, but you did that as opposed to, you know, throwing on a wig for the role. And I think that it was a subtle yet impactful decision, especially in a film with characters of color. How important do you feel as if that representation is?
I think that representation is beyond important. I have a 8-year-old daughter. The Crown Act has just been passed in most states here in the United States, which allows men and women to wear your hair as it grows out of your head. No longer telling me that my hair, because it's locked and has this curly bush on top, is not professional, or that your beautiful Senegalese locks are not professional enough or glamorous enough. So I've been very intentional, especially with this film and projects before, but especially with this one, because this is a woman who works in corporate America, who helps people of every color, who has to sit in boardrooms and sit across people that are very high powered. And her boldness and confidence in her truth, in the way her hair grows out of her head, in the complexion of her skin, not trying to tone it up or down in any way, and loving everything that is about her and her unique origin. I think so many Black women are going to look at this and go, you know what? I could wear my locks to work too. Mm-hmm. I could go to a fancy gala and still be considered beautiful with my hair like this too. So it is a message that I want to send to every sister out there, no matter what age you are. A lot of our elders grew up in a world that told them that they cannot have their hair looking shot off their head. And that's not the truth. The truth is this is how my hair grows out of my head. And it's beautiful. It is my crown. And so Nicole Barnes wore her natural crown on purpose, for sure.
Well, well done. Love the movie, and happy holidays to you both. And thank you for speaking with us today.
Thank you, Brenda.